Good evening, my dear friends. In this session, we will discuss about the civil remedies available against bank frauds. Friends, there are several remedies I told you, civil and criminal. Civil is with regard to get compensatory package and then damages. Criminal is to punish the culprits. So in this case, what are the remedies available on civil lines, in civil law, for getting appropriate compensation, recovery and damages? This is what we are going to see, my dear friends. So, with regard to civil remedies, the first legislation which will give us necessary relief happens to be the Indian Contract Act 1872. Friends, in this particular proviso, the bank loans obtained by means of coercion, fraud, undue influence, misrepresentation, they are all voidable. Okay? If the bank loan involves any of these things, they are voidable. Sections 15 to 19A of the Indian Contract Act contains the necessary provisions in this regard. And the parties are under a mistake as to the matter of fact or law, then the agreement is void, of course, under sections 20 and 21 of the Indian Contract Act, whether it is unilateral or bilateral. Then if the consideration is unlawful or immoral or opposed to public policy, also the agreement is void under section 23 of the Indian Contract Act. Then if the consideration and object are unlawful in part, the agreements are void under section 24 of the Indian Contract Act. So these are all the basic provisions. It invalidates that particular transaction. Then you come to section 17. 17 of the Indian Contract Act is more relevant in this particular subject matter, where the fraud is defined. Fraud is here defined as means and includes any of the following acts committed by a party to a contract, or with his connivance, or with his agent, with intent to deceive another party thereto, or his agent, or to induce him to enter into the contract. I am just repeating the proviso. What are the? The suggestion is a fact of that which is not true by one who does not believe it to be true. Then the active concealment of a fact by one having knowledge or belief of the fact, a promise made without any intention of performing it, any other act fitted to deceive, any such act or omission as the law specially declares to be fraudulent. Then, friends, the explanation says mere silence as to facts likely to affect the willingness of a person to enter into a contract is not fraud unless the circumstances thereon show that the regard being had to them. It is the duty of the person keeping silence to speak, or unless his silence is itself equivalent to speech, that is deed. So friends, these ingredients are mostly prevalent in banking frauds, and the remedy is a common law remedy. Through a civil action and file a suit seeking return of money, compensation, as I told you already, or seeking damages. In this case, Derry versus Peake is the most important judgment, a decision of the House of Lords, UK, reported in 1889, 14 AC 337. The House of Lords in this case observed that fraud means a false statement made knowingly or without belief in its truth, or recklessly, careless, whether it be true or false. The fraudulent misrepresentation is a false statement which is made by a person who does not believe it to be. That is the most important aspect. He does not believe it to be true, but he expresses it. Sorry. In this case, the Supreme Court in Sri Krishna versus the Kurukshetra University, reported in All India Reporter 1976, SC 376 page, observed in a different way, I would like to read it so that it would be beneficial to you. Quote, in order to constitute fraud, the person making the statement must have been aware of the falsity of the statement and the party defrauded remains ignorant of the correct situation. Fraud is committed where one person induces another to enter into some contract or transaction on a false belief by a representation of fact which is not true and which he does not believe it to be true. That is the most important aspect. But if the other party has the facts before it or has the means to know, he cannot be said to have been defrauded. Even if a false statement has been made, even if the motive of the person indulging in deceit is laudable, he cannot escape from the consequences of this action. It's a landmark judgment of the Supreme Court, dear friends. And then, unquote, in the light of this decision, based on the evidence of fraud, an appropriate relief could be granted to the courts, by the courts to the victims. Apart from that, sections 142 and 143 of the Indian Contract Act say that in case of any guarantee obtained by misrepresentation or concealment, the guarantee is invalid. The guarantee includes the bank guarantees and the bank can refuse to make the payment. I already discussed these matters most elaborately while dealing with these guarantees. I have already discussed. Then, friends, the second civil remedy is torts. Torts is a civil wrong. So, it's a judge-made law taken by the doctrine of stare decisis, where the bank is vicariously liable to the affected customers for the frauds committed by the banker's staff. So, as an employer, the banker is liable vicariously for the misdeeds of the servants, employees. The Supreme Court has seized this matter in State Bank of India versus Shama Devi, reported in AIR 1978, Supreme Court 1263, and further in Bank of Bihar versus Mahabir Law, reported in All India Reporter 1964 SC, page 377. So, friends, with this particular background, one is under the Indian Contract Act and the other one is under the law of torts, the appropriate remedies can be invoked through the civil jurisdiction, civil courts. And then the civil courts will grant appropriate reliefs. One is recovery of money, another is compensation, damages, and so on and so forth. So, with this background, we can, in fact, close the discussion. But there is one more thing also. In case of public sector banks where fraud is involved, even a constitutional remedy can be invoked under Article 226 of the Constitution of India. So, with this background, we conclude our discussion on the civil remedies available to the affected persons in case of banking frauds. Then, friends, the last breath of our discussion of criminal remedies, I will deal with that in my next lecture. Thank you very much, and then good night. Goodbye.